Good morning and welcome to our service this morning, and a very special welcome for all of Maya's family and friends. It's lovely to see you all here with us this morning, and we look forward to Maya's baptism as our service unfolds. Intimations are in print, and hopefully you received a copy as you came into church this morning. A couple of things. First is to note that the craft club that's normally on a Monday, that's not on tomorrow. So that's the craft club is cancelled tomorrow. It will be back on next week as usual, but if you perhaps know folks that are go to that, not here today, could you maybe just make sure that they are also aware that it's not on tomorrow? And we also have a retiral collection in aid of Christian Aid's Libya flood appeal. So there's an opportunity to donate to that cause today after worship and also next Sunday. Now those are all of the intimations this morning. So as we prepare for our worship, let us turn to today's thought for prayer and let us pray. God, open to us today the sea of your mercy, and water us with full streams from the riches of your grace and springs of your kindness. Make us children of quietness and heirs of peace. Kindle in us the fire of your love. Strengthen our weakness by your power, and bind us close to you and to each other. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. And a very warm welcome indeed to our worship here in St. Mary's today, where we're here to do a number of things. We're here to sing to God's praises. We're here to learn more about Jesus and God's love. We're here to baptize Maya into the family of God, to pray together to the God who hears each and every voice, and to grow more and more into the likeness of Jesus, the true vine, who wants everyone to be connected. And so we're going to stand together, and we're going to join our voices and our hearts in praise by worshiping God in our opening hymn, which is 113 in our church hymn book, God the Father of Creation. 113.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Well, as I said, great to see everyone here today. I've got some things I'm going to read out, and I wonder if you can tell me what they all have in common, what they're used for. A mobile phone, Facebook, WhatsApp, Zoom, Royal Mail, Twitter, and email. What do you use those things for? And somebody's already said it here. What do you think, Grace? Talking, yep, talking. And someone over here said communication. Absolutely. We use these things to communicate, to stay in touch and keep connected. And whether we might not be on Zoom or Facebook, but we probably all have sent a letter and used the telephone. And it's good to keep in touch. It's good to be together because we weren't made to be on our own. And last week in church, we were thinking about some of the I am sayings of Jesus. And we were thinking about Jesus saying, I am the good shepherd. And we remembered his words about the importance of folks recognizing his voice. And today in church, we're going to be thinking about another of those I am sayings. And it's Jesus saying, I am the true vine. A vine. Now, there's all sorts of vines. But I think the one that Jesus was talking about was one that maybe looked a bit like a grapevine that had lots of branches all interconnected together and producing lovely fruit. And Jesus says, if you want to produce lovely fruit like that, then you have to remain in him to stay connected. Now, we can't send God a letter. We can't call him up on the phone. And we can't add him as a friend on Facebook. So how do we communicate and talk to God? Any ideas? Yeah, I've got a hand up here. Hello. Pray, you're absolutely spot on. We pray, don't we? Do we need to be in church to pray, do you think? Absolutely, we don't. We can pray in church, but we can pray anywhere and at any time because we're told that God never sleeps. So even in the middle of the night, you can talk to God. Do you have to use special words or a fancy voice to pray to God? Definitely not. You just be yourself. Do you have to bow your head and clasp your hands and close your eyes? Sometimes. Some people find that helpful. You block out everything else and you just focus on talking to God. You can do that, but you don't have to. There's lots of ways to pray. Do you have to be a member of a church to pray to God and talk to him? No, absolutely not, because anyone can talk to God. And I reckon that God is delighted when we take a moment to say, hello, God, it's me, and tell him how you are feeling, because God made each one of us, and God loves us. So we're going to be thinking a wee bit more about this, Jesus saying, I am the true vine, as our service unfolds today, and as we move towards Maya's baptism. And in a moment, we're going to sing together, but first, we're going to do what we've been talking about, and that is to pray. So let us pray together now. Living God, source of all things, we come this morning to remember that we are in you and you are in us, together, one, united. For in and through Jesus, his birth, his life, his death and resurrection, you have ended division, reconciled heaven and earth, and made it possible to be connected and in touch with you. You have no phone, yet we can talk to you. You don't have Facebook, but you are our friend. You don't have Snapchat, but you know our stories. You don't have Instagram, but you still want us to follow you. For we are your children who belong to your family, linked to one another through your wonderful love for each one of us. Lord God, when we have neglected to keep in touch and missed out on the opportunity to be encouraged by your love, when we have been choosy in our caring and forgotten your command to love one another, when we have been more interested in our story and overlooked the bigger picture, and when we have been unfaithful in our following and ignored the people who needed to know your compassion, forgive us and renew us this morning, we pray. Through word and song and prayer, come, Holy Spirit, and remind us again of our call to abide in your love. Convict us again of the truth that nothing can separate us from you, and inspire us again to trust that together, come what may, is always better than going it alone. For we are in you and you are in us, together united. May we believe it and cherish it and make it increasingly so. For we ask it all in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we're going to sing again, and it's a very short little song. And John's going to play it through once for us, and then we're going to sing it together three times. And the good news is there's actions if you want to join in. So it's 145. And it's called God Made Me As I Am. And as John plays through, I'll try and remember the actions for us. Please be seated, everyone. So we've now come to the part of our service where our young church are going to head across to the halls where there's some fun and activities for them to do there. and then they're going to come back in at the end of the service for Maya's baptism. And if there's any young people in our midst who would like to go and enjoy the fun across in the halls, then you're very welcome to go and do that just now. And don't worry, you'll be back in time and you won't miss out on Maya's baptism.
The reading today is taken from John chapter 15, verses 1 to 12. Jesus, the real vine. I am the real vine, and my Father is the gardener. He breaks off every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and he prunes every branch that does bear fruit, so that it will be clean and bear more fruit. You have been made clean already by the teaching I have given you. Remain united to me, and I will remain united to you. A branch cannot bear fruit by itself. It can only do so if it remains in the vine. In the same way, you cannot bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me. Whoever does not remain in me is thrown out like a branch and dries up. Such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire, where they are burnt. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you will ask for anything you wish and you shall have it. My Father's glory is shown by your bearing much fruit, and in this way you become my disciples. I love you just as the Father loves me. Remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be complete in you, and that your joy may also be complete. My commandment is this: love one another just as I love you. Amen. And may the Lord give his blessing to this reading from his holy word. We're now going to sing our next hymn, which is number 604, Holy Wisdom, Lamp of Learning.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, all week long, as I've been thinking about the reading for this morning, there is a song, or rather a line of a song, that has been playing rather annoyingly over and over in my head. Does that ever happen to you? A wee earworm gets in and the same song goes over and over. And these are the words. I'm going to get myself, I'm going to get myself, I'm going to get myself connected. And now it's in your heads. Can anybody remember what advert that featured in? Yeah, it's a phone advert. You're absolutely spot on. It's the Car Phone Warehouse. And when I had a wee Google, I felt very old because YouTube showed it up as 1996. That's how long that advert has been around for. The Stereo MC song, Connected. And it points to a very important theme in our reading this morning, as we turn to yet another of the I Am sayings of Jesus. I am the real vine. And Jesus spoke these words to his friends on the night before he died. And we find them between chapters 13 and 17 in the Gospel according to John. And in those chapters, we get a real sense that Jesus is encouraging his disciples and reassuring them that although he is leaving them, the connection with him is real, and it will and it can continue through the work of the Spirit, the advocate, the friend that he is going to send to them, even though he physically won't be present with them. And so in these verses alone, we have the word remain or abide used over and over again. It's almost as if Jesus is repeating himself so that there will be no doubt and that we will get the message loud and clear. Remain. Remain. Abide. Keep in touch. Stay connected with Jesus, the real vine. Now, Jesus didn't just use this image because it was random. He used it because it was familiar to the people of his day. Vines were everywhere in Palestine. And in the Old Testament, in places like Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and the Psalms, it's God's people, Israel, who had been associated and symbolized as the vine. However, when we read those accounts of the prophets, we hear that God's people aren't always faithful. God expected them to treat each other with justice and with mercy and with compassion, but instead they oppressed. They had turned away from God's loving ways and they didn't bear good fruit. And so as Jesus talks, he has that in mind, but now he's saying something else. He's saying that he is the true vine. He isn't talking about Israel, he's talking about himself. He's claiming to be the real vine, a vine that doesn't run wild or wane or rot, but is true and is faithful, and says that the key to fruitfulness is to be found in him. I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me. But those who do not remain in me are thrown out like a branch and dry up, and such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire where they are burnt. Pretty sobering words that should make us sit up and take notice, both in the challenge they give and the comfort they offer of that call to remain and abide and make our home in Jesus just as he does in us. to get ourselves connected and live in and for him. And so I suppose the question for us all this morning is, how is that going for you? And how do we do that remaining and abiding? We know we don't need Wi-Fi or 5G or Royal Mail to communicate with God. But how are you keeping in touch, staying connected? I was recently behind a bus as I was driving along the high street, and in the back of the bus was a massive poster that said, "Try praying." Have any of you been behind a bus like that or seen that billboard? Try praying. And so I googled the site and had a wee read of the booklet that I downloaded. And I was fascinated by what it had to say. It says that some 27 million adults in the UK pray, 10 million pray regularly, and half of those believe that God hears our prayers. And of those who say they're not religious, 1 in 5 pray. I reckon if I was to ask you, and well, we've all already done it today in terms of praying, there's not one person here who would say that they've never prayed. Most people have. A prayer of please, a prayer of thank you, a prayer of wow, a prayer for help. Sometimes no words, just sighs or cries. And as we've said, we don't need a special formula or fancy words. You just need to show up, keep it simple and honest, trusting that as you do so, God is there and is delighted that you are speaking to him. There are lots of nuggets of wisdom in this book here. How to Pray, a simple guide for normal people, written by Pete Gregg. And there was some words in particular this week that touched me. Pete writes this: "The thing is, God likes us a lot. God wants to spend time with us, even more than we want to spend time with him. This is a mind-blowing truth. It means that whenever you make the effort to approach the Lord in prayer, he's already waiting there for you with a smile." That's an amazing thought, isn't it? That God likes us a lot and wants to spend time with us. Of course, sometimes when we turn up in prayer, we aren't smiling. We aren't even talking. We might be silent or shouting. We are angry. We are confused or disappointed about something that has happened. And you know what? That's okay. God can handle that too. The important thing is that we remain, that we abide, that we keep connected and keep on talking to God, as surely as God wants us to talk to him. And you know, there really isn't a right or a wrong way to do that. For some, it will be sitting down and opening up our Bibles. For some, it will be listening to music. For some, it might be as we walk the dog and find ourselves chatting to God. For others, it will be switching off the computer or their mobile phone. Maybe it's saying a prayer out loud as we drive our car or whilst doing our housework, or quite simply sitting quietly with our eyes closed or maybe a candle lit. Whatever it is, the significant thing for us to remember this morning is the importance of the intentionality of doing it, of keeping in touch with our God, because prayer has power. It connects us with the source of all life and all love. Of course, if I was to go around this sanctuary just now and ask you, well, what does prayer do? We would have a whole spectrum of opinions. For some, you will think if you pray long and hard enough, then God will give you what you want. As I mentioned a few weeks ago, there's even some people that think if they pray when they're driving around a car park, that God will find them a space. There's folks on the other end of that who think that prayer is a complete waste of time. It doesn't make a difference. It doesn't change anything. God is powerless to act. And then there's folks in the middle who aren't sure, unconvinced one way or the other, but are willing to give it a go. Only you will know where you are today when it comes to prayer. But amidst all of that, let me offer a word of caution. And to say that if you're sitting here today and you think that prayer is about a negotiation or an exchange, God, if you do this for me, then I'll do that for you, then you're probably going to be disappointed. I don't think prayer and God work like that. After all, we live in a world where blessing and misfortune don't always discriminate. Bad things happen to good people and vice versa, despite our best efforts and prayers. Life can be cruel. It can be unfair. And being connected to Jesus the vine is no guarantee that life will always be easy and cheery. Prayer doesn't always give us what we want. Well, why bother, you might say. Well, because as Christians, life is more than our wants. And keeping in contact with God is much more of a need. It connects us to the source. It reminds us of who God is and who we are in Him, the true vine. So this week, why not have a think about prayer? Reflect a little more about the ways that you seek to connect with God, and better still, just do it. If you've got a mobile phone, amidst all the apps that you can download, there's one called Try Praying, or there's a Lectio 365 that guides you through a daily prayer, or come along to St. David's Memorial Park on Wednesday night and learn together from one another and from Pete Gregg and others about the different ways that we can pray together. For regardless of what you think prayer can and cannot do, as followers of Jesus, we are called to love one another and bear the fruit of love in acts of justice and mercy and compassion and peace. And that begins and it ends by remaining, abiding, keeping in touch, making our home, and staying connected to Jesus, the real vine. Amen. And so I've done a lot of talking about prayer, and now we're going to do it again. This time coming before God with our prayers of thanks, and specifically with our prayers for other people that we know and folks who are in need in our world. And I'm going to leave you silences throughout, so it's not just my voice, but you too can add yours. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, the true vine, though we cannot see you as once your disciples did, so we trust that through your Holy Spirit, we are connected to you. And whenever and wherever we pray, God hears. He hears the sighs and the cries, the gratitude and the wonder, the questions and the confessions, the requests and the urgent pleas. And though sometimes our prayers are not answered in the time or the way we might like, so our speaking to you, our remaining in you, gives us strength and hope and peace throughout it all. And so we come before you again to pray, praying for each one of us gathered here and watching online, that we might find time and ways this week to draw closer to you, to pause, to wait, to listen for your words, and to speak to you in our ordinary, everyday voice, believing that you love us and are always ready to hear our prayers. Lord, help us to connect with you and to remain and abide in your love. We pray for those whom we love, in our families and circle of friends and church, giving thanks for the connections that mean so much, the folks who keep us going and on track, who remind us of how much we are loved. May we find ways to tell or show them how much they are valued this week. We bring their faces before you now. We pray for those who we were once very close to, and now, for whatever reason, don't keep in touch with. Folks we haven't spoken to or connected with for some time. We bring them to mind now, and we pray for them. And we pray for all those in our world today who are feeling lonely, forgotten, disconnected from all that is life-giving, and those who are ill or worried or grieving today. And as we look at our news screens, so we pray for ceasefire in Karabakh, peace in Ukraine, and help and aid in Libya and Morocco, to name but a few. In the silence, we raise all the need up before you, Lord, and pray that you will guide them into and hold them in your love. Lord Jesus, the true vine, who hears these and all our prayers, spoken out loud or uttered in the silence of our hearts, keep us faithful that we might remain, abide, and stay connected in and with you, and bear the fruit of love. So be it. Amen. Baptism is a reminder that we are all connected in God's family, the church. And so as we move towards Maya's baptism just now, and as the young church prepare to come back over from the halls, we're going to turn to the back of our intimation sheet, and we're going to stand together and we're going to sing, Conceiver of both earth and heaven. Please be seated. Perfect timing. Welcome back, everyone. There you are. Looks like you've all been busy. I think you've been making vines across in the hall, haven't you? Fantastic. There you are. Well, folks, it's a delight to welcome Katie and Sandy here with little Maya this morning. And Alexander and Taylor, too, who were baptized as babies at this font, Maya's big brothers. Baptism, well, it's not a magic formula, but it is an affirmation of something which is already true. And that is that God loves Maya. And today, as we baptize her through water and the Spirit, so we welcome her into the family of God's church. Jesus loved children, and we're told that when the disciples tried to keep them away from him, he said this, "Let the children come to me. Don't try and stop them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, whoever does not enter the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it." Jesus wasn't a baby when he was baptized. He was baptized at the beginning of his ministry. But as he went down into the Jordan and emerged from it, so we're told that the sky opened up and the heavens broke and the Spirit descended on him like a dove. And God said, "You are my beloved Son, in you I take delight." And just as Jesus was baptized, so before he ascended back to his Father in heaven, he said to his friends, you go and tell them the good news of God's love and baptize everyone in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I will be with you to the very end of time. We come in gratitude then today that through the waters of baptism, Maya is assured of the love that God has for her. And as a sign and seal of the Holy Spirit is placed upon her, we affirm together that she belongs to God. And so, with all of that in mind, Katie and Sandy, can I ask you please to stand? Katie and Sandy, today do you give thanks to God for the gift of Maya? And in bringing Maya for baptism, do you confess your faith in God, the loving Creator, in Jesus Christ, in and through whom we are promised life, and in the Holy Spirit, our helper and our guide? Can I ask you folks to come round here? And can I ask Maya's godparents as well to come and stand at the side? Now, we couldn't possibly have a baptism without water. And so Taylor and Alexander, if you want to come out just now, and together, why don't you pour the water into the font? There you are. Great job. Well done. Thank you, boys. Yeah, if you want to just stand there so you can see your baby sister being baptized. And as we prepare to baptize Maya, let us pray. Gracious God, this morning as we prepare to witness and celebrate the sacrament of baptism, we are reminded that this is a special day made possible by you. For in baptism we see a sign of your love that reaches out to welcome everyone. We see a symbol of your grace that is poured out so that all might be renewed and made whole. And we see the seal of your promise to us, as through water and the Holy Spirit, you claim us as your own, set us free from the power of death, that we might follow and grow in the way of your kingdom, and live in your vine, your presence forever. And so, gracious God, as we come with thankfulness for this day, for the gift of Maya and her family, and for the love which surrounds us all, we pray that you would encircle us all with your presence, fill us with your grace, grant us your peace, and send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this water as you claim and seal Maya as your very own. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you all please stand? Are you coming, Maya? Hello. Yeah. Oops. Hello. There we go. We're sorted. We'll go over here. There you are. Is everybody come to see you? Maya, Michelle, Agnes Ralston, today we say loud and clear that it was for you that Jesus came into this world. It was for you that he lived and he showed God's love. It was for you that he suffered the darkness of Good Friday and cried at the last, "It is finished." It was for you that he rose to newness of life on Easter Day and rose to newness of life. All this he did for you, which just goes to show that we can love God because God first loved us. And so we get to baptize you today, and we come to this font and we take some water. Maya, Michelle, Agnes, I baptize you into the name of God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. May the blessing of God Almighty descend upon your heart and remain with you forevermore. Amen. Amen. Let us sing together. The Lord bless you and keep you, which is 796. That went well. I'll give you back. Oops, a daisy. There we are. Get you all sorted out. There we are. Yeah. Maya is now baptized into the fellowship of the faith divine, and we receive and we welcome her as a member of the one holy and apostolic church. There will always be a place for her here and in Christ's vine. And so with all of that in mind, Sandy and Katie, do you promise with God's help to continue to provide a loving home for Maya and to bring her up in the faith of the gospel as far as you are able in the fellowship of the church? You're a lucky girl, Maya, because you've got four godparents. And so with Joyce and Rachel and Lee and Stevie as godparents, do you promise to do all you can to love and care for Maya and to be a source of encouragement and support as she grows up? Thank you. And as family and friends and as this gathered congregation, do you promise to set a good example to all children in our midst and live lovingly, peacefully, and kindly with one another, bearing good fruit? The answer is we do, and we're going to try that again. Do you promise? Thank you, thank you. May God help us all to keep this promise. Please be seated. Have a be seated. Well, as a reminder of this day, our young church have a little gift for Maya. Here we are. Thank you, Grace. No problem at all. And before we sing our final hymn, well, we've baptized Maya, but it'd be lovely to pray specifically for her and for her family today. So let us pray. God of love, as Maya grows and makes her way in the world, guide and guard her, we pray. We pray that there will be more laughter than tears, and we pray that your love will hold her, that your truth will direct her, so that as she grows, she may listen up for your call and come to know you for herself. Bless her parents, Katie and Sandy. Bless her godparents, Lee and Stevie, Joyce and Rachel. And bless her big brothers, Taylor and Alexander. giving to them all, Lord, wisdom and patience, laughter and peace, and that love that endures all things. And as we leave the font today, may we all be touched anew with the promise of baptism and receive a spirit of joy and hope that enables us to face the future with courage, trusting always in your loving purposes and seeking in all our living to be followers of Jesus who stay connected and bear the fruit of love. May it increasingly and always be so. Amen. Amen. And so we turn to our closing hymn, which is 562, Through the Love of God our Saviour. Let us go and confide in God, abide in Jesus, and stay connected, and be open to the Spirit guiding your way in the world this week. And the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all this day and remain with you forevermore.